فجعلناهم سلفا ومثلا للآخرين.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله
الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أي عباد الله، ها هو ذا شهر رمضان قد آذن بالرحيل، ولم يبق لنا منه إلا القليل، لكن قليله الباقي هو زهرته، وما مضى منه كان بداية مضماره. قال الحسن البصري رحمه الله تعالى: إن الله جعل شهر رمضان مضمارا لخلقه يستبقون فيه بطاعته إلى مرضاته، فسبق قوم ففازوا، وتخلف آخرون فخابوا، فالعجب من اللاعب الضاحك في اليوم الذي يفوز فيه المحسنون ويخسر فيه المبطلون. ولئن كان رمضان قد خص بغفران الذنوب، فإن ليلة منه يزيد فيها الغفران عما سبق وما يلحق. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم كما في الحديث المخرج عند البخاري من حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه: من قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. وما جاء النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بهذه إلا ليحفز أولئك الذين تقاعسوا بداية الشهر، أو أنه ما كان قيامهم إيمانا واحتسابا، فكان قد ملأ قلوبهم الضجر من طول القيام. فها هو ذا الآن يأتي رمضان بزهرته بعشره الأخير منه، فليشمر الجادون وليستعد الراغبون لملاقاة تلك العشر بانشراح الصدر وطمأنينة النفس وزيادة الركض إلى نهاية المضمار، عل وعسى أن يكون من الأوائل الروابح. كما زيد أجرها، أعني تلكم الليلة ليلة القدر، عن عبادة ألف شهر. قال تعالى: إنا أنزلناه في ليلة القدر. وما أدراك ما ليلة القدر؟ ليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر، تنزل الملائكة والروح فيها بإذن ربهم من كل أمر، سلام هي حتى مطلع الفجر. وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: تحروا ليلة القدر، أيقصدوها وترقبوا لها وتربصوا بها، وفرغوا أنفسكم فيما يظن أنه من لياليها. ومن كان متحريها، يقول صلى الله عليه وسلم: تحروا ليلة القدر، ومن كان متحريها فليتحرى في الوتر من العشر الأواخر من شهر رمضان. رواه البخاري. ولذلك فقد شرع للمسلم في هذه العشر عبادة أخرى إضافية أكثر ما تكون في رمضان، ألا وهي الاعتكاف، وهو لزوم بيت من بيوت الله بقصد الانقطاع لله وتفريغ القلب من جميع الشواغل الدنيوية والعوالق الدنية، والإقبال على العبادة قياما وذكرا وقراءة قرآن. والسنة الاعتكاف في العشر الأواخر من رمضان، لحديث أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه أنه قال: كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعتكف في كل رمضان عشرة أيام، فلما كان العام الذي قبض فيه اعتكف 20 يوما، يعني من آخر رمضان. رواه البخاري. وقد نص أهل العلم أنه يجوز الاعتكاف ولو لأقل من العشر، ولكن ليس بأقل من يوم واحد. أما ما ذهب إليه الناس من أن الاعتكاف يكون ولو لساعة أو بعض ساعة فليس على ذلك دليل ولا أثارة من علم، ولكن الاعتكاف إنما يكون بلزوم المسجد والمكث فيه ليس لأقل من يوم وليلة حتى يفرغ القلب من جميع الشواغل الماضية ويتخلص من جميع الهموم القاسية التي لطالما أبعدته عن الله. والاعتكاف عباد الله عبادة عظيمة ينبغي على من تلبس بها أن يتعلم فقهها ليبتعد عن مفسداتها وما ينقص أجرها. ومما يبطل الاعتكاف المباشرة مباشرة الأزواج، لقوله تعالى ولا تباشروهن وأنتم عاكفون في المساجد. والمباشرة تكون بالجماع ومقدماته. ومما يفسد الاعتكاف أيضا الخروج من المعتكف لغير حاجة وضرورة كعيادة الطبيب إن كان هو مريضا، إن كان المعتكف مريضا لا يقوى على تحمل هذا المرض فإنه يحل له أن يخرج إلى الطبيب ثم يعود فورا دون المرور إلى منزله ولا إلى الأسواق وغيرها. ومما يفسد الاعتكاف أيضا ذهاب العقل سائر اليوم أو أكثره، فإن من زال عقله أرفع عنه التكليف، لقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم رفع القلم عن ثلاثة منهم والمجنون حتى يفيق. وكل من زال عقله بإغماء أو جنون فإنه قد خرج من اعتكافه لأنه قد رفع القلم عنه ولا تكليف عليه. ومما يفسد الاعتكاف أيضا الحيض والنفاس للمرأة لفوات شرط الطهارة، وأما الاستحاضة وهي تدفق الدم بعد انقضاء مدة الحيض والنفاس فإنه لا يؤثر في الاعتكاف، كون بعض أمهات المؤمنين اعتكفن في مسجد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعليها الحيض وعليها الاستحاضة وكان يوضع لها الطست تحتها لئلا يقطع الدم على أرض المسجد. ومما يكره للمعتكف باعتكافه الخروج للبيع والشراء أو لعيادة مريض أو لاتباع جنازة أو لغير ذلك مما لا يلزم ضرورة وهو في معتكفه. فعن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت السنة على المعتكف أن لا يعود مريضا ولا يشهد جنازة ولا يمس امرأة ولا يباشرها، والمقصود بامرأة زوجة أو نحوها، ولا يمس امرأة ولا يباشرها ولا خروج لحاجة إلا لما لا بد منه، ولا اعتكاف إلا بصوم، ولا اعتكاف إلا في مسجد جامع، أخرجه أبو داود بسند حسن. ومما يكره أيضا في حال الاعتكاف الكلام بالباطل كالكذب والغيبة والنميمة والاستهزاء والاحتقار والسب والشتم وقول الزور والصخب برفع الصوت لغير حاجة. هذه أمور تنقص من أجل الاعتكاف وتؤثر في أثره على النفوس. فمن أراد الاعتكاف فليعلم أنه يبدأ بغروب شمس يوم العشرين من رمضان الذي هو أول لحظات العشر الأخير منه، وينتهي بغروب شمس آخر يوم من رمضان. أيها الناس، اغتنموا هذه الفرص التي أنعم الله بها عليكم وأنتم لا تزالون في أمن وأمان وسلامة وإسلام وعقل وقوة في الأبدان، فاغتنموا هذه الفرص فلا تفوتوها. فكم ممن هم حولكم ممن يرجون أن يقوموا بهذه الشعيرة، غير أن الأمن والأمان قد فات بلادهم واضطربت أحوالهم، فلا يأمن الواحد منهم إلى أن يأتي المسجد لأداء الفريضة فضلا عن سنة كسنة الاعتكاف. اغتنموا هذه الفرص التي قد لا تعود عليكم، واجتهدوا في إرضاء ربكم واستغلال أوقاتكم وتزكية نفوسكم والتدرب على كل ما فيه صلاحكم وإصلاح دنياكم وأخراكم، عل الله عز وجل أن يبدل حال أمتنا من هذا الحال الذي هي فيه إلى حال هي فيه أحسن منه. أقول ما تسمعون، وأسأل الله بمني وكرمه أن يغفر لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين، إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله الهادي إلى رضوانه، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وآله وأنصاره وأعوانه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، عباد الله، فإن العبادات من صلاة وزكاة وصوم وحج وعمرة وغيرها مما شرع الله عز وجل من العبادات، إنما شرعت لتهذيب النفوس ولتهذب النفوس وتزكي القلوب وتكسر حدة الكبرياء عند البشر. وهكذا وأيضا وفوق ذلك، وإن كل ذلك ليؤدي بالضرورة إلى قيام هذه النفس البشرية بالتعرف على ربها، فإنها متى ما تخلصت من الشرور الدنية والكبر والجبروت على البشرية فإنه يسهل عليها الرجوع إلى الله، لأن الله عز وجل قد نفى عن آل فرعون أنهم ما علموا، فقال سبحانه: وجحدوا بها واستيقنتها أنفسهم. وجحدوا بها أي علموها، ولكن الكبر منعهم من قبولها. وقد قال صلى الله عليه وسلم: الكبر بطر الحق وغمط الناس. فإن هذه النفس البشرية متى ما تخلصت من هذا الكبر بلزوم هذه العبادات، أدى ذلك إلى ازدياد من الطاعات وإلى تذللها إلى رب الأرض والسماوات. أقول عباد الله إن أعلى ما يكون من ذلك توحيد الله عز وجل، فعلى المرء أن يتعرف على ما يوحد الله به، وأن يتعرف على ما يغضب الله عز وجل من الشرك والبدع، ليبتعد عن ذلك كله ويحذره ويحذر منه أهله ومن يراه من المسلمين. ومن ضمن هذه العبادات التي تؤدي إلى كسر الكبرياء في النفس البشرية عبادة الاعتكاف، وهو الانقطاع في بيت من بيوت الله تذللا وخضوعا لله. فمن لم يكن مستحضرا لهذه القاعدة الشرعية المستخلصة من القرآن والسنة فلن ينتفع بشيء من هذه العبادات. والمسلم الذي يصلي ويصوم ويزكي ويحج وربما اعتكف ثم هو يتكبر على عباد الله ويحتقر من ليس هو من طبقته، وهو ايضا يأتي الخياطين ويطلب منهم ان يصنعوا له ثوبا ويطلب ان يرخوه دون الكعبين، وهو امر محرم شرعا وبنص قول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم انه كبر وانه في النار. ولا فرق في ثياب الرجال ان كانت ازرا او قمصا او سراويل ما يسمى بالبناطيل اليوم، فان كل ثوب يلبسه الرجل لا بد ان يكون فوق الكعبين، والا كان كبرا اعترف او لم يعترف. وهو ايضا اعني ذلكم المسلم الذي يصلي ويصوم ويزكي ويحج وربما اعتكف لا يعتني بماله من اين اكتسبه وفيما انفقه، وما اذا كان مسرفا مبذرا ام كان بين ذلك قواما. وهو ايضا لا يراقب ما يتلفظ به ان كان زورا او كذبا او كان حقا وصدقا ام كان غير ذلك. والله عز وجل يقول وما يلفظ من قول الا لديه رقيب عتيد. فلا ترات اثر تلك العبادات على هذه النفوس. والمرأة التي صلت وصامت وزكت مالها وحجت ولربما اعتكفت وهي لا تزال تعيش بمفهوم الطبقية ومبدأ الأنانية وتعشق الإسراف والتبذير المفرط في ملبسها ومسكنها، وهي أيضا لا تراعي حق زوج في طاعة وحفظ لماله وأبنائه ونفسها، وهي أيضا لا تزال خراجة ولاجة ولا تزال سافرة الوجه أمام الرجال الأجانب، ولا تزال تتعاطى ما يلفت أنظار الرجال إليها من صوت أو رائحة أو ملبس، وهي أيضا لا تزال تخيط ملابس سهرتها بما لا يتماشى مع الهدي الإسلامي لا شكل لا وصفا ولا ثمنا، وهي أيضا لا تزال على المخالفات الشرعية مقيمة. فأين أثر تلك العبادات على هذه النفوس؟ أيها المسلمون، ها هو ذا رمضان قد أوشك على لملمة متاعه وإعلان الرحيل عنكم، فاستفيدوا مما بقي منه لتصلحوا فيه أنفسكم وتستعيدوا فيه قواكم وتقووا فيه إيمانكم، لعل الله أن يعيد لأمتنا مجدها التليد وعزها الماضي البعيد. واعلموا عباد الله أن الله إنما يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فأديموا ذكر الله يذكركم واشكروه على عموم نعمه يزدكم، وصلوا وسلموا على نبيكم يصلي ربكم عليكم، ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون.
اعتدلوا تراصوا تقاربوا تناظروا سدوا القلب.
الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. تبارك الذي جعل في السماء بروجا وجعل فيها سراجا وقمرا منيرا وهو الذي جعل الليل والنهار خلفة لمن أراد أن يذكر أو أراد شكورا وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما والذين يبيتون لربهم سجدا وقياما والذين يقولون ربنا اصرف عنا عذاب جهنم إن عذابها كان غراما إنها ساءت مستقرا ومقاما والذين إذا أنفقوا لم يسرفوا ولم يقتروا وكان بين ذلك قواما والذين لا يدعون مع الله إلهًا آخر ولا يقتلون النفس التي حرم الله إلا بالحق ولا يزنون ومن يفعل ذلك يلقى أثاما يضاعف له العذاب يوم القيامة ويخلد فيه مهانا إلا من تاب وآمن وعمل عملا صالحا فأولئك يبدل الله سيئاتهم حسنات وكان الله غفورا رحيما ومن تاب وعمل صالحا فإنه يتوب إلى الله متابا. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. والذين لا يشهدون الزور وإذا مروا باللغو مروا كراما والذين إذا ذكروا بآيات ربهم لم يخروا عليها صما وعميانا والذين يقولون ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما أولئك يجزون الغرفة بما صبروا ويلقون فيها تحية وسلاما خالدين فيها حسنت مستقرا ومقاما قل ما يعبأ بكم ربي لولا دعاؤكم فقد كذبتم فسوف يكون لزاما. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. Thank you.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
استغفر الله. استغفر الله.
الحمد لله، الصلاة والسلام الأتمان الأكملان على محمد رسول الله، سيد الأولين والآخرين، وإمام الأنبياء والمرسلين، والشافع المشفع يوم الدين، وعلى آله الطيبين وأزواجه الطاهرات أمهات المؤمنين وصحابته الغر الميامين، وبالأخص منهم خلفائه الأربعة الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي، ومن استنى بسنته واهتدى بهديهم الى يوم الدين. اما بعد، dear brothers and sisters, حياكم الله to the to this khutbah in which we mentioned the rulings of i'tikaf and it is one of the duties of the last nights of Ramadan. I said at the beginning of it, our slaves of Allah, here is the month of Ramadan. Already declared the departure of it, and nothing left of it except the little. But this little remaining of Ramadan is the fruit and the nectar of Ramadan. And what has already gone of it is only the racing field of it, or the beginning of the field of racing in it, and the race is not yet finished. Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala said, verily Allah ta'ala made the month of Ramadan as a field of racing for his creation, so that they race in it with the different types of obedience to adhere and to gain his pleasure. As for some people won this race and some others lost in it. And then he said, the real surprise, the real surprise is what you see of that person who is laughing and playing in the day in which the serious ones won and got their prizes, and the lazy ones have lost. And if Ramadan was given some type of speciality and forgiving the sins. However, there is a night in it that can also guarantee this forgiveness, and this is from Allah Ta'ala, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in the hadith reported by Imam Bukhari on the authority of Abu Hurairah رضي الله تعالى عنه. من قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا, he whoever stands or be found standing or be using that night, stands on the night of Al-Qadr, all of the previous sins of his would be forgiven. And in other narration that I forgot to mention in the khutbah, in other narration, وما تأخر وما تأخر, and it is authentic. What is preceding the past of the sins, and what is what is going to be committed in the future. And this does not mean that one go and do sins, because to reach that level of worship and obedience is something that does not allow you to come down to lower level. It will not allow you. Automatically your soul is ready only for obedience, and it will hate the disobedience. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is emphasizing something important here in this hadith. If you've been lazy on the last 20 nights of Ramadan, now use the time. It's still the chance. The chance is still there. Do not lose it once again. Free yourself now for worshiping Allah during these last 10 nights. As you may not come back to them next year, nobody knows but Allah. And the reward of it is nothing like. Even the whole last 20 nights where you stood sincerely for the sake of Allah, all behind the Imam, and you are given the reward of standing whole night, although you stood maybe 1 hour or two, but this night will tremendously be more than that. As Allah Ta'ala said in Surah Al-Qadr, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ, we have descended it, meaning the Quran, on the night of Al-Qadr. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ, what will make you know what is لَيْلَةُ, what is the value of لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ. لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ, the night of Al-Qadr is even better than 1,000 months. What does that mean, 1,000 months? In the time frame, no. And you are. It is better than worshipping with no stop, day and night. Worshipping with no stop, day and night, more than 1,000 months. If you multiply, if you divide 1,000 months by 12 months, which are the months of the year, you will come to have more than 83 years. Maybe many of us will not even reach that age. So in one night, you are given the reward of worshiping as a pious person, the best pious person, as a best pious person for more than 83 years. Maybe more than your age. And even if we say your age, still in all of this age, you, if you see how much you worship Allah, it may not even come to the quarter of your age. And we're going to compress it like that day and night. It will not even reach a quarter of your age. Because your age, maybe half of it or one quarter of it was spoiled and gone. And the rest of it, you may become practicing, but how often, how much? Do you make mistakes or not? Do you commit sins or not? Do you have shortcomings in your worship or not? But when you stand that night alone, you're going to be given the reward of more than 1,000 months, more than 83 years. Many of us, their fathers did not live for 83 years. So look to the grace and mercy of Allah Ta'ala that He bestows on His creation. But where are they? Where are they? And other than the two holy mosques, what do you see people doing at the Kaaba? I didn't see even a single one in this masjid since built. And every year we are encouraging people by a very powerful khutbah like this, bringing all the ayat and hadith to encourage them to come and do i'tikaf. But where to see them? Where to see them? During the time of Sahaba, even women did used to do i'tikaf. Even women who are in bleeding and the excessive bleeding after menses or giving birth periods, they come to the i'tikaf and they may put a big plate or a container and for them to stay in so that the blood doesn't spread on the ground of the masjid, on the floor of the masjid. Why we can't see these people? Why we can't see them? From the 1,000 million Muslims, you only see those few ones in the two holy mosques. Where are the rest? What about the other masajid? The opinion that says that there is no i'tikaf except in the three masajid is not the right opinion. It's not the right opinion. And I'm going to read to you what Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said. And she must have heard it from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if we are going to take opinions, then the opinion of the Sahaba is better than the opinion of others, even if they are scholars. And who gonna be a scholar like Aisha? Aisha was not a normal person. Aisha was a scholar, a great scholar. The male companions used to come back to her asking her about the affairs of Islam. So where are they? Is it because of this hadith? I doubt. Because very little number of Muslims take this opinion. But the majority, because they cannot leave their very soft and comfortable mattresses. They cannot leave their whatsoever private things, family, business, entertainment. Allah knows best what it is. The reason that they don't go for i'tikaf. Subhanallah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تحروا ليلة القدر. He's encouraging the ummah to seek ليلة القدر. How to seek it? Isa said, وَمَنْ كَانَ مُتَحَرِّيَا whoever is seeking it فَلْيَتَحَرَّى فِي الْوِتْرِ مِنْ عَشْرِ الْأَوَاخِرِ مِنْ رَمَضَانِ. As in Sahih al-Bukhari, let him to seek it on the night on the odd nights of the last nights of Ramadan. And that's why i'tikaf is made permissible for the Muslim in order to be on the Laylatul Qadr. And i'tikaf is to stay, to remain in one of the houses of Allah that are scattered on the earth with the intention to free yourself only for Allah and free your heart from all the dunya things, worldly life things, and to come completely for worship. Not 1 hour, 1 hour. No kidding, no playing, no entertainment, no jokes, no laughing, but seriousness and worship. Seriousness in worship. The like of standing the night prayers with the Imam. All of it. Don't go to the Holy Mosque with the i'tikaf and only do the last 13 rak'at after 1 o'clock in the morning and say, oh, whoever asked, akhi, that's a different thing and a different issue. Don't lose your time, don't waste your time. You are there to worship Allah, to worship Allah. Sitting, talking, reading books other than the Quran. This is not what i'tikaf is for. And that's why Rasulullah ﷺ did not give any one class, any single class during his i'tikaf. And that's why the Sahaba and the Tabi'een and the Tabi'een, the scholars amongst them, used to close their books of hadith when Ramadan, the whole Ramadan comes. Rather than the last night. And also, if you are in the i'tikaf, you're told to free yourself all the night, especially the night, for worshiping Allah. When the jama'ah are praying, you pray with them. 10, 23, 39, you pray with them. You pray with them. Those who do not pray with the jama'ah are the ones who oppose the hadith. When we say hadith, we say the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, who stands behind his imam until he finishes. Until he finishes. And he does not necessarily mean a person, but it means the salah. As I said in many occasions, if we are praying Asr, if I am leading the salah in here in this mosque, in my mosque, leading Asr, and after 2 rak'at, I lost my wudu. I have to go and make wudu again. And then I'll pull someone behind me to continue the prayer. Are you going to leave the salah and say, okay, my imam left, I leave? That is not correct, ya akhi. That is not correct. So these imams are not in different prayers. These imams are in one prayer, helping each other. So, yani if this imam, and I ask them, if we say that the imam, we have two imams. Let's take for example in Medina, Hudaifi and Hussein al-Sheikh. They are leading the night prayer one night. But Hudaifi decided to take only 2 rak'at and give the remaining 6 rak'at for Hussein al-Sheikh. Shall we leave behind after Hudaifi finish and say, khalas, we done all night prayer? Subhanallah. We'll form this understanding. Where from this understanding? The Prophet ﷺ clearly said, whoever stands behind the Imam until he finishes. Finishes what? Finishes what? Finishes the Salah. The word finish does not mean him, but it means the whole Salah. And the Imam himself, for example, Hudaifi or whoever, finishes. And then he does not leave. He go back and let Hussein al-Sheikh, for example, come forth. So he did not leave. How can you leave? And you say that, oh, I'm up on the sunnah and the rest are not. Believe me, you are not up on the sunnah. You are not up on the sunnah. This is not the sunnah. Because the sunnah, we have sayings and actions. The Prophet ﷺ in his sayings, he directed the speech to the Ummah, what to do as a follower of the Imam. His action is good to be for the Imam. We advise the Imams to do 11 rak'at. We advise them. But we cannot say it is forbidden. It is better for the imam to do 11 rak'ah. But if the imam decided to do 23, you as a muqtadi, if you want the reward that Rasulullah promised, you have to do as what he said. Stand behind the imam until the imam finishes. Meaning until the whole prayer is finished. Till the whole prayer is finished. Not until one imam leaves or one imam comes. And if you go, if you want to go for sunnah and bid'ah, then we ask you, did Rasulullah when he leave the prayer 3 nights in his masjid, or Abu Bakr, maybe Rasulullah, they would say, okay, Rasulullah will not allow anybody to, yani, and it is not correct to have any imam leading the Prophet Sallallahu okay. During the lifetime of Abu Bakr, during the lifetime of Umar, Uthman Ali, did they allow anybody to do like that? I don't mean it is not allowed, it is permissible. But if you want to come to Sunnah and Bid'ah, then how come you say to something that Rasulullah ﷺ said and directed to the Ummah that it is Bid'ah? He ﷺ said, he talked to us, the Ma'mums, the ones who pray behind the Imam. If you stand behind the Imam until he finishes, meaning until the Salah finishes, because during their time, the one who leads the Imam used to be one. One. Not switching. It does not mean that switching between two or three is haram. No, it's not haram. But they did not used to do it. That's why Rasulullah said the Imam. And it means the Salah, the whole Salah. The whole Salah. And as I said, let's take the other hadith. Yani, ya ikhwan, we need to have fiqh. We don't need yani, books of hadith. As Imam Albani rahimahullah ta'ala said, when a young man is presented to him, is introduced to him as someone who's memorizing Bukhari and Muslim, he said, MashaAllah, we had a new edition now. We had a new edition. What does he mean by that? It's when we have edition 1, edition 2, is a new edition. And then he explained what does that mean. He said, we want people who memorize the hadith but understand it. How the fiqh. How the ummah lost today? By less a hadith scattered, spread it? No, ya akhi. Today, the people, most of the Muslims know the hadith da'if from the hadith sahih. Easy to know. Easy to know. For example, Imam Albani, he went to most of the books of hadith and he compiled them into separate sets. For example, Sunan Tirmidhi, Sahih, Volume 1, 2, 3, 4. Da'if, Volume 1, 2. Sunan Ibn Majah, same thing. So, easy to distinguish now Sahih and Da'if. Easy. But is the Ummah now better in Iman, better in obedience, or worse? They are getting worse. Definitely, they are getting worse. Why? Because no fiqh. No fiqh. And what we need today is the fiqh, the understanding of these ayat and hadith, ikhwan. The understanding. Not to come, oh, this is hadith sahih. Yani you think that those imams and those ulama do not know that this is hadith sahih? They know, ya akhi. They know it. And you got to study the fiqh of Islam. Oh, we don't need to study madhab. Because madhab is haram. Who said madhab is haram? Every one of these scholars you see have studied madhab. Albani studied madhab of Abu Hanifa. Ibn Baz studied madhab of Ahmad Ibn Hanbal. It's not wrong. What is wrong is to be extreme on the madhab. Meaning, the hadith of Rasulullah comes and you say, no, I will take the statement of Abu Hanifa, not the hadith of Rasulullah. That's not accepted from anyone. Followers of Abu Hanifa, followers of Ahmad, followers of Shafi'i, followers of Malik, however, it's not accepted. When the hadith of Rasulullah comes, nothing else to precede it. Nothing. We all have to come and follow it. But to study the madhab, how the ulama and understand the hadith, that is something good. Yes, even in that, some madhab is better served. I mean, when I say better, I mean it is served more than the others. More than the others. So, يعني when you see for example Imam al-Nawawi was Shafi'i. So you say that Imam Nawawi is not right, he was wrong. He was Abu Madhab and you mashallah the very tiny and minor and little. You know better than him? Subhanallah. That's wrong, ya ikhwan. So we have to study the fiqh. And that's why Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he subjugated the good for Ibn Abbas, what did he say? Allahumma allimu faqihu fi al-din wa allimu al-ta'wil. Oh Allah, give him the fiqh in the religion and teach him the interpretation. Because the narration and interpretation is to be taught. And the fiqh is to be on the whole religion. The whole religion. So we have to understand that, ya ikhwan. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did not direct neither the Imam nor the Ma'mum by the number of rak'at of Qiyam al-Layl. He did not say do not do this or do this. But he صلى الله عليه وسلم, as Aisha said, never added more than 11 rak'at. طيب, okay, that's good. Let Aisha tell us how these 11 rak'at. 1 hour time? She said, 4 rak'at, don't ask how long, how beautiful they were. And then 4 rak'at, don't ask how long, how beautiful they were. And then 3 rak'at. And Ibn Mas'ud telling us that he prayed behind him one night. And Isa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited Al-Baqarah. And Nisa, and then came back to Al-Imran in 1 rak'ah. Can you do like this 11 rak'ah? I used to go to a masjid opposite of the main building or post office in Balad, and where the old fish market, there is a masjid there alone, nothing around it. And they used to pray Qiyam al-Layl beginning from around 12:30 and they finish by just before Fajr, half an hour or maybe less than half an hour, and they serve sahur for people. But you know how many people were there? You know how many people used to pray there? Until today, if you go, maybe you don't find the Imam and maybe 4, 5, 6 only. This mosque in the Jum'ah Khutbah is full, fully packed outside. They have shades. Why? Because the Imam at that time was Egyptian, speaking against governments. They like it. When it comes to the way that they say it is the Sunnah, and we say it is the Sunnah of Rasulullah to stand long standing in night prayers, you don't see them. Where are they? Where are they? Only 4 or 5? Subhanallah. If this number was the number in Jum'ah, this masjid would have been closed. But people, yani, subhanallah, if they pray long, they say, wallah, the Imam prayed too long. If they pray short and more numbers, the Imam has opposed the Sunnah. MashaAllah. You're the one who's doing the Sunnah. الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد ورب الضالين آمين قل أعوذ برب الفلق قل أعوذ برب الناس الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده even not one time سبحان ربي العظيم and then they say this is the sunnah 11 ركعة is the sunnah سبحان الله who said that تاخي the night prayers better to be long in standing long in ركوع long in سجود and 11 ركعة But if it is not that long, and when you say long, not lesser than as Umar radiallahu anhu did, and I mentioned this in last Friday, that he used to tell the Imams, who is fast, you recite 30 ayat in rak'ah. Who slow, who is slow, 20 rak'ah. Who is middle, 25 rak'ah. In 1 rak'ah, 25 ayat, in 1 rak'ah. 25 ayat in 1 rak'ah. Today, let's take the one who is very low. لا لا سوري let's take the one who's very fast. How many ركعات recite? 2-3 that's it. Half page. Half page. 2-3 only. And then do ركوع. And I'm wondering when these imams come to the ayah of depth, ayah of Dain in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is one full page, what are they gonna do? 2-3 lines and then they do ركوع? They skip. They skip. They jump it. They jump it because this ayah cannot help them. Subhanallah. That is wrong, Ikhwan. So both teams are wrong. Those who make it so fast and those who make it yani limited to 11 rak'at only. Even if the imam is doing more, they pray only 10. And I asked these people. Aisha said he did not used to pray more than 11 rak'at. Okay. Are you going to pray 11 rak'at with the imam? He pray with the first imam, then this is 10 rak'at. And then he leaves. You prayed only 10. You opposed the sunnah, you did not pray 11. He did not pray 11. Oh, I will wait until he's in the witr. Until he's in the witr. But you then did not do what Rasulullah used to do. And what Isa said to you. Because if you say, okay, I leave now after the first imam left, and then I join in the witr. I say, okay, let me ask a question now. Who's going to lead the witr? Is he the same imam that you prayed behind? He's not. He's not. In Mecca, for example, first 10 rak'at, Abdullah Awad, Jani. Then Sudais comes after him. So if you pray with Abdullah Awad, you're gonna do witr with Sudais. So two imams, not one. Come back to the same problem, two imams. Not one. So okay, this is not understanding. This is not the proper understanding. There is a fiqh for the imam and a fiqh for the ma'moom. The fiqh for the imam is better to be 11 rak'at, long recitation, long ruku, long sujood. The fiqh for the ma'moom is to stand behind the imam until he finishes. Until the prayer is finished. Until the whole prayer is finished. Now, so we don't have to mix. We don't take half from here, half from here, and fabricate a new thing. No, that's wrong. That's wrong. So, i'tikaf is in the last 10 nights of Ramadan, as in the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, in Sahih al-Bukhari, that he said Rasulullah ﷺ used to do i'tikaf in each Ramadan, every Ramadan, for 10 days only, and it was the last year of his age, of his life, in which he was and his soul was taken and he died, he passed away. He did i'tikaf in 20 days, meaning the last 20 days. And the people of knowledge said that i'tikaf cannot be for lesser than a day and a night, full day, 24 hours. Some people say no, you can't do i'tikaf even 1 hour, half an hour. If you wait in the masjid after salah for 20 minutes or half an hour, intend i'tikaf. What's this? This is kidding. Where is this in the hadith? Where is this in the sahaba, if they have done it? Did they do that? I'tikaf, as Aisha radiallahu anha said, whole day. Whole day. Not 1 hour or less than 1 hour, la. This is not i'tikaf. You're gonna be rewarded for staying in the masjid, no doubt. It's something good to come and stay in the masjid. But you do not consider it i'tikaf. Oh, I'm doing i'tikaf. La, this is not i'tikaf. Naam. And i'tikaf is a great worship, all people, all Muslims, that everybody who is practicing it got to have the fiqh of it. So that he stay away from whatsoever nullified. Stays from so whatsoever nullified, and also from whatsoever shorten the reward of it. from whatsoever can shorten the reward of it. And from the thing that nullifies the i'tikaf is what Allah Ta'ala mentioned in Ayah 187 of Surah Al-Baqarah. He said, Allah Ta'ala said, وَلَا تُبَاشِرُهُنَّ وَأَنْتُمْ عَاكِفُونَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ. تُبَاشِرُهُنَّ here means sexual intercourse and what yani preceded. Speaking about sex, kissing, touching in a way, you know, of desire. All this can yani nullify your fasting. Your i'tikaf. Can nullify your i'tikaf. Also, leaving your place of i'tikaf for no valid reason. No valid reason. You only leave your i'tikaf if you want to go to the toilet. If you are sick and you cannot yani cope with this pain, then you go to the doctor. If you want to eat and they don't allow food inside the masjid, so you go outside just near, not you go outside to restaurants and some of them they say, okay, the eggs in restaurants are not good. We go to far restaurants and you know they look for names and brands and some special food, pizza and toast and what is that? Are you in i'tikaf or in a picnic? If they bring this food for you, leave the i'tikaf, or if it is allowed inside, then no problem. Eat whatsoever you want, no problem. We don't say don't eat, but don't can waste your time and leave your i'tikaf looking for the better food. Going out for a better food now. Especially that you know that now when you go out to buy any food, you're gonna be mixed with the women, you're gonna hear things, you're gonna... What is your i'tikaf? I'tikaf means you stay away from all these things. Now, so, and you know, and also from what nullifies the i'tikaf is losing sanity by whatsoever reason, whatsoever, but for the whole day or most of it. If one full in unconscious case, he full unconscious for the whole day or the whole night, what is that i'tikaf? This i'tikaf is gone. That i'tikaf is gone. He can re-intend the i'tikaf once he come back to sanity. Also, the blood of menses and bleeding after giving birth for women. This also nullifies the i'tikaf because i'tikaf is to worship. And main worship in the masjid is a prayer. And this woman cannot pray. And the, So she cannot do the i'tikaf when she is. But if she is in istihaba, which is the excessive bleeding after menses period or after the period of bleeding after giving birth, that is a different thing. And we only allow because it was found that one of the mothers of the believers, wives of Rasulullah sallam, used to do i'tikaf when she was in istihaba, not in the hayd, menses, not in the nifas, which is bleeding after giving birth, but istihaba, which is the excessive bleeding over these two periods. That is allowed. Now, because the woman in istihaba still can pray. She has to pray, she has to fast. Now, and what is disliked in the i'tikaf is to go out for buying and selling. Although it does not nullify to some of the ulama, not all, some others say it nullifies the i'tikaf. Or also visiting a sick person. Again, some of our ulama said it nullifies, some it said it doesn't, but it is disliked. Now, and also to follow the janazah. Now, as Aisha radiallahu anha said, as sunnah to al mu'takif, the sunnah for the one who's in the i'tikaf, ألا يعود مريضا, that he does not visit a sick person, ولا يشهد جنازة, and he does not follow لجنازة ولا يمس امرأة and he does not touch a woman meaning a wife or a woman that he can have desire with. But your mother, that's a different thing. Your daughter, that's a different thing. Now, ولا يباشرها and he does not enjoy her by hugging, kissing or sexual intercourse if you are in the i'tikaf. ولا خروج لحاجة إلا لما لا بد منه. And you do not go out of your i'tikaf for anything except something that you badly need. Not you need, not except something you need, لا. But something you badly need. Toilet. We don't say you need, but you badly need. Food. We didn't say you need, you badly need. Because if you don't eat, you cannot continue your worships. You cannot be strong to stand and pray. And so you eat, no problem. Now, and then she said, وَلَا اعْتِكَافَ إِلَّا بِصَوْمٍ. And there is no اعْتِكَافَ except during a fasting day. وَلَا اعْتِكَافَ إِلَّا بِمَسْجِدٍ جَامِعٍ. And there is no اعْتِكَافَ except in a masjid which is jami', which Jum'ah is prayed in. And this statement from Aisha is authentic, reported by Abu Dawood, and it is authentic. So this also clarifies where the i'tikaf to be. Not only in the three masajid, but any masjid that the Jum'ah is conducted in. And from what is disliked for the one who is in the i'tikaf is the false speech. False, whatever is false speech, disliked speech by Allah. Like lying, slandering, backbiting, deceiving, false witnessing, wronging others by speech, cursing, insulting, raising your voice for no reason. If you are calling someone, no problem, it's far and you're calling him, raising your voice to make him hear, no problem. If you are teaching, no problem. If you are leading the prayer, no problem to raise your voice. But for no reason, laughing and talking loudly, and that's not correct. You are not in a coffee shop. You are in the masjid for i'tikaf. You are the greatest worshiper now. You cut off yourself from everything and free it for Allah. So how can you do that now? Now, so whoever wants to or intends to perform i'tikaf this year, let him to know that i'tikaf begins with the sunset of the 20th of Ramadan. Because the first day of the last night begins from the sunset. Like, first day of Ramadan began by the sunset of last day of Shaban. And that's why last day of Sha'ban, when the sun set, we pray Taraweeh. And it ends by the sunset of last day of Ramadan. And that's why last day of Ramadan we don't pray Taraweeh. On that evening we don't pray Taraweeh. So there are many different opinions. Some of the scholars said the morning of 21st. Some say the sunset of 21st, but the proper opinion is the 20th, because logically, once in Islam, the day which is 24 hours, the night precedes the daytime. Yani, what we are going to receive today in the Maghrib time by the sunset, it's called the night of Saturday, not night of Friday. That's the night of Saturday. Now, so by the sunset, the new day is started. In the West, they say by midnight. No, by the sunset. By the sunset. Now, so it begins by, tomorrow is the 20th. We are Friday today, 19th of Ramadan, 1432. Tomorrow is the 20th. Whoever intends to get into the i'tikaf, then tomorrow by Maghrib he must be in his i'tikaf. Tomorrow, Saturday, 20th. Huh? لا tomorrow night. Tonight there is no صلاة القيام as they call it. There will be no صلاة القيام at 1 o'clock. Tonight there will be because tonight we're what day is tomorrow? And 20 belongs to which 10? Let's divide the month into three groups. First 10, middle 10, last 10. So tomorrow belongs to which one? Second. So second is not the last. When it starts, you count 1, 21. So that 1 is tomorrow by the sunset. Saturday, sunset of Saturday, that begins the first day of i'tikaf. On first day of last 10 days. Now, and ends by last day, whether it is 29th or 30th. If they see the moon on the 29th, meaning it is 29 days of Ramadan, and that's it, then that's the end. But if they don't see it, and you fast the 30th of Ramadan, by the sunset, that's the end of your i'tikaf. When do you leave the place, the i'tikaf? Different opinions again. Some of them said that whoever performs i'tikaf does not leave the i'tikaf until he prays the Eid. And some others said no, by the sunset, and that's the proper opinion. Because Rasulullah ﷺ did not used to pray Eid in the masjid. And the i'tikaf was in the masjid. He did not used to pray Eid in the masjid. They used to pray Eid outside, yani, and not even very close to the masjid. Because around the masjid there were houses. So they used to go a little bit far. So the proper opinion is to enter the i'tikaf by the sunset of the 20th and to leave by the sunset of the last day of Ramadan. Now that was the first khutbah. And the second khutbah, I began saying, praising Allah Ta'ala and raising the praise to Allah Ta'ala and sending peace and blessings to Rasulullah, his family, his companions, and those who follow him. And then I said, as i'tikaf is to remain in one of the houses of Allah, to show Allah or to humiliate yourself. When we say humiliate, we means by showing your weakness to your Lord, showing your need to your Lord. Yani invoking your Lord, pleasing Him. We do not mean by humiliating yourself to do bad actions or bad yani things. La la la. When we say humiliating, to means to be an obedient slave. That's it. Now, so who doesn't have this this fundamental principle of worship in the Sharia of Islam, which is taken from the Quran and Sunnah. All the worships, Ikhwan, all the worships you do to show your Lord your weakness and your need. To show Allah that you are weak and you need the power and strength from Him. To show that you are in need for everything from your Lord. That's the purpose of the worships. Allah Ta'ala doesn't want you to worship Him so His dominion increase. La! It's only for yourself. Your soul be purified. Now, so that Muslim who prays, fast, gives the charity, perform Hajj and perform i'tikaf, but he wronged the others and lowered them and looked to them in a bad way, how come he benefited from this worship? He cannot be benefited. If you look to people, if he still continue seeing people low, so how come did he yani benefit from the prayers or fasting or zakat? How come? He still disdain, he still have kibr, pride and arrogance. Now, and that one who prays, fasts, give charity, perform Hajj, perform i'tikaf, but still go to the tailors and ask them to make him clothes and make these clothes long to extend and to go below the ankles intentionally. He said, go down, go down. Where's the worships? How did the worships affect on him? This is one sign of kibr. Oh, I don't mean kibr. You mean you don't mean you are told that this is a sign of kibr. Don't do it. Don't do it. That's it. And also he, this person who prays, fast, give charity, perform hajj, perform atikaf, doesn't care about his income. Halal, haram, he doesn't care. And when he takes it, he doesn't care how he spends it. Wasting in a good way, not a good way. Now pleases Allah, doesn't please Allah. Help other with, doesn't care. He doesn't care. So how come this person be benefited out of these, or from these worships? And he, this person who prays, fast, gives charity, performs hajj, performs atikaf, but doesn't watch what he says, lying, cursing, insulting, slandering, backbiting, suspecting others with no reason, then how he has benefited from this worship? Allah Ta'ala said about the prayer, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنَهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ. Prayer stops from fahsha and munkar, the wrong and false sayings and actions. And Allah Ta'ala told us that fasting provides taqwa, piety. And he, Allah Ta'ala told us that charity is zakah, which is purifying the soul. And Allah Ta'ala told us that hajj takes the one out of sins, like if he's born. So where are the effect of all these worships with this person who doesn't care? Where is the effect of these worships? And also that woman who may pray, fast, give out charity, the obligatory charity, and may perform hajj, and maybe perform atikaf, but she still live with the mentality of racism and what we call that, and leveling people. She is, this woman is from low tribe, and this woman is from high tribe, this woman is from poor family, and that woman is from high family. She is my servant, but this is my friend, subhanAllah, I'm both Muslims. She still live with this mentality. This servant going to be next to your house in the Jannah, having maybe same or better than your house in the Jannah. This servant, even if she is a slave, she might have in the Jannah something better than you, sister. Bilal radiallahu anhu was an Abyssinian slave who the Arabs see very little. But the Prophet ﷺ in his lifetime told him that, Ya Bilal, tell me what you do, because I hear your footsteps in the Jannah. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I don't do nothing, but every time I lose my wudu, I perform wudu. And every time I perform wudu, I pray to rak'ah. So by this thing, he was given the glad tidings of the Jannah before many Sahaba, many others. He was given the glad tidings. Another man who was very common, nobody, he wasn't that important person amongst the, meaning very, high level Sahabi, like Abu Bakr and Umar. They are important because they were very close to the Prophet ﷺ, and they were like the advisors and helpers and supporters of Rasulullah. That man, even his name, we don't know his name. The Sahabi, the narrators, did not tell us his name. Isa ﷺ said for 3 days in row, a man of the people of the Jannah will come from this gate. He was the same man for 3 days. When Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As went to his house and stayed with him for 3 days to see what this man does. He didn't find him doing anything more than the rest. And then he asked him, why Rasulullah said so? He didn't say to him, maybe because I, when I go to bed, I never sleep with having any hate against any Muslim. Any hatred against Muslim. No hatred in my heart against Muslim. I wipe everything out before I sleep. Just for that. Now look, you may be good worshiper, but you still have the hate in your heart. Not to your Muslim brothers, but to your Salafi brothers. You hate them, you mock them. Or with you in the same way, but because they have different yani, opinions or like that. So that's why yani, the Muslim sister need to understand this. And also she still live with the selfishness and greediness, everything for her. Even the style of the clothes. If any sister said, MashaAllah, this is the night dress, from where you bought it? My husband bought it from France, from here. I got it as a gift, I didn't buy it, I got it as a gift. She doesn't want to tell her from where. Why? Because she doesn't want the second one like her. And even in the house, oh MashaAllah, you got a nice coach, from where you get this, from where did you furnish it? Oh, I don't know, my husband did it. Ask your husband, okay. Tomorrow, I forgot to ask him. So, because she doesn't want to like him, SubhanAllah. SubhanAllah. And once any woman buys the same dress, she goes to the corner and cry. She's not the Cinderella today. Where's the ibadah, the effect of the ibadah on you? And also she loves wasting money. She prays this, but she loves wasting money. Look at them these days. I mean, at the night, after Taraweeh, if you see the, look, we have an extra place for women up on the second floor that only is visited in Ramadan. Only in Ramadan, because we have plenty of them. Now, mashallah, good. After Taraweeh, where did we go? Souk, market, immediately. From the mosque to the market. Spend 2-3 hours of the night in the market. In Taraweeh, they spend only 1 hour, maximum. So they leave Taraweeh, they leave masjid, and they go for 2-3 hours in the market. Or more. And that would be every night. Allah musta'an. Wasting money. And a businessman today, especially in Ramadan, whatsoever was before Ramadan 10 riyals, now it is 20, 30 riyals. And still people buy it. Still people buy it. Not for the need of it, just because, oh, it's a new style. It's a new style. And I hear something very strange. Wallah, in all of my life, this year I hear this for the first time. They don't want to buy shoes because new style is coming. It's a shoes, style shoes. Even the shoes style, SubhanAllah, waiting for the style of shoes, SubhanAllah. That sounds very strange. Not because the market doesn't have new shoes and they are selling the old and new shoes. No, but because they want the newest of the new, the very latest models of shoes, SubhanAllah. Models in shoes, what model in the shoes? It's shoes. You put it on and you step over dirt, over everything. Shoes, SubhanAllah. Until now I didn't hear style, waiting for a style of underwear and undershirt and... Maybe there is, I don't know, I didn't hear. And if not, I am expecting maybe next year. Because every year they do like the car makers. Same car, same model. Next year they bring it with a line on the side. New model. New model. And people sell their cars and go buy this with more money. Oh, a new model. What's different between this and what you have? Oh no, didn't see the difference? They back light is round. It used to be rectangular. Subhanallah. What makes wasting money is that? Subhanallah. Go and buy the back light and put it. Finish. Sell the old car and buy a new car, waste thousands of riyals just for that. And same thing, shoes and underwear, subhanAllah. And also, yani, as I said, wasting and wasting, and that's why you see the men working overtime in Ramadan, looking for other job in Ramadan, besides their job, they work yani, in the morning until near about Asr, in their normal work, and then they go market work for some shops at night. Why? Because his wife is waiting for money, and if he doesn't do that, he may not even sleep of the, you know, screaming and shouting and crying and this and that, and maybe she leaves home, go to her parents' home, and subhanAllah. So we have, want to yani, be careful of that. And also she doesn't even care about the rights of her husband. She prays, fast, perform hajj, give charity, perform atikaf, go for umrah, mashallah, he said the Quran. Where is the right of the husband? She doesn't obey him. She doesn't yani, listen to him. Where is the right of the husband? Where is the right of the husband? Now, she doesn't yani, save him and his money and his children and even herself. He doesn't like her to go out this way. But she doesn't care and go out this way because she likes. La, the real pious Muslim woman does not put what she likes before what her husband likes. If what her husband likes is not haram, if it is not haram, he, what he likes must come first, even in food and drinks. She likes orange juice and he likes banana juice. She must do the banana juice, not the orange juice. Why? Because this is what pleases him. And if he is pleased, Allah is pleased with her. If he is unpleased, Allah is unpleased with her. It's not an oppressing, la, but because he is the man, ya ikhwan. He is the man. He is the one, yani mandatorily support his family financially, security, defense, help, whatsoever. He is the one responsible about this family and about this house. Not she. So he has a right over her. Now the king, the president, is responsible about yani, the economy, about defense of the country. That's why he has a right over us. We obey him. We have to obey him. Because he's too busy, he's too worried about us. And he worked for us. Same thing now. The husband worries about his family and he works for them. He works for them to provide them very comfortable life, but based on the Sharia. Not comfortable life away from the Sharia, based on the Sharia. Now, so this woman prays, fast, perform hajj, get charity, maybe do i'tikaf, but she's always entering and exiting the house. She doesn't care. Anytime she wants anything, she just put the abaya on and leave the house. Husband come from work, nobody in the house. She comes, where are you? Where were you? My friend came from travel and I went to see her. From whom you get permission? Oh, am I a slave? No, you are not a slave. You are a slave of Allah. And your Lord Allah commanded you not to go out until you ask permission. So how come you go out? Oh, I went out to buy something. Who allowed you? Who allowed you? This is not correct. And at the same time, the husband must not be يعني an oppressor and lock her up in the house like a prisoner. No. But يعني when he comes from work and take a rest and like that, eat, take a rest, then he takes his wife and go both to the market if she needs something, and they go both to visit her family or like that. He the one accompany her. He does not يعني he does not deny her rights, and she does not oppress him by ignoring him and ignoring his rights. That's wrong. Both of the actions are wrong. And also, she might be praying, fasting, performing hajj, giving charity, doing i'tikaf, but she still insists to go to the tailors and make dresses which are far away from the Islamic dress, exposing her breast, exposing her back, exposing her leg, exposing her thighs, exposing her stomach. And she says, oh, I'm only at yani, the presence of sisters. Even at the presence of sisters, you still need to wear loose covering clothes, as Aisha said, radiallahu anha. Not this, or she goes and make tight clothes, or wears trousers and jeans, and nothing, the shirt does not cover to the knee. If the shirt covers to the knee, no problem, but the shirt is short or it's under the trousers, under the pants. That's wrong. Or she goes and buys yani styles with something written on which is bad. It came from the West, and they just all pictures of actress and like that. That's all wrong. Where is the effect of the worship, the obedience? And also she prays, fast, performs hajj, gives charity, and performs i'tikaf, but she's still yani continuing on many sins and disobedience to her Lord. So where is the effect of the worship now? Where is it? If the worships cannot take us from one level to a better level, then these worships are either not sincerely for Allah or not based on the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we all, men and women, need to go back at these days, remaining days of Ramadan. Ikhwan, every one of us knows somebody that he saw or talked to or heard about last Ramadan. But this Ramadan, that person has passed away. You don't see him anymore. You don't hear him anymore. You don't hear about him anymore. He's gone. So what makes you safe not to be gone next Ramadan, but next day, tomorrow? Who can guarantee that you live until you get to the end of Ramadan? So we have to correct our situations now, correct ourselves, correct our ways, go back to sincerity, go back to the way of Rasulullah, go back to the life, style of life of the companions, men and women. Let's read about the companions. How did they used to live, Ikhwan? Is it something shame? Can you show me any shameful style of life of any of the Sahaba? It's very wonderful life. Everyone hears about it and says, MashaAllah Abu Bakr, MashaAllah Umar, MashaAllah Abu Dhar, MashaAllah Fatima, Aisha. Yes, true. They were very, very yani advanced in the yani in life, in style of life. Let's now copy them, not copy our enemies. not imitate our enemies. And do like John and Julian and whatsoever. لا أخي. Let's follow our great examples, the companions of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. والله تعالى أعلم. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه. وجزاكم الله خير بدرجة الكرسي. On Paltalk and Wizig, Wizig you can write it down. Paltalk you can raise your hand. Go ahead. Huh? 10 days? 3 days? No problem. We said that the minimum is 1 day. If he wants to do it, to have 3 days, no problem.
1 day also?
24 hours. But not less than that. Less than that is okay, but it's not considered to be a tikkab. Because Umar ibn Khattab vote to do a tikkab 1 day. So Rasulullah told him to fulfill it.
But for the women in the house?
Even, i'tikaf is only in the masjid, not in the house.
For the ladies?
No. Even ladies.
Ladies
masjid, the Umm Salama, the Hafsa, all the wives of Rasulullah, did i'tikaf in the masjid. لا. It is, i'tikaf is to stay, remain in a house of Allah. Not a house of any of us.
One day also, minimum.
Yes, one day minimum. بارك الله حياك الله.
And
when?
Maybe it's 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock.
Finish. Even 1 minute.
Yeah.
Before Maghrib, before sunset, that day is not considered. She has to make it up.
And then the fast is gone. Fasting. And
then. Yeah, the reward Allah will give the reward, but she has to make this day.
In the same, and she could go to Umrah. During the Tawaf she came to Mother. Then Tawaf continued.
She came on?
Same position.
La, because Rasulullah told Aisha when she had the menses,
yes.
He told her, do everything that the Hajjaj can do, but not Tawaf. Not Tawaf, not Salah.
She can stay.
She can stay.
Nah.
Yes. Barakallah. Okay, there's a question from Palta. Go ahead. Pure your intention, go ahead. Pure intention, say Barakallah fiik, Ameen wa fiikum Barakallah. Is it allowed to do i'tikaf outside of the month of Ramadan? Or what about in the first 20 days of Ramadan? It is allowed to do i'tikaf in any day of Ramadan, first, middle, last, but the best is last. And it is also allowed to do i'tikaf in other than Ramadan, naam, but with fasting according to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And some of the ulama say it is even no problem to do it without fasting. But of course it is better to be with fasting. Okay, Dawood, go ahead. Dawood says, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Do the last 10 days. When do the last 10 days start? We mentioned that in the khutbah and in the translation. We said that it starts by the sunset of the 20th of Ramadan. Today we are on the 19th, Friday. Tomorrow, Saturday, is going to be the 20th. Of Ramadan in year 1432. So by the sunset of tomorrow, Saturday, the last 10 nights starts and the, what they call it, the Tahajjud, starts also. Send us, go ahead. Send us wa istabrak, go ahead. send us your stuff. Regarding سحور, Sheikh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani رحمه الله تعالى mentioned the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if one of you hears the call to prayer and the vessel is in the hand of one of you, then let him not put it down until he fulfills his need from it. Can you explain this? Yes, Sheikh. Like if I have my water, can I finish it? Barakallahu me. Naam, it is exactly like what you understood. But if the cup is in your hand, not the water is in the fridge, and you go to the fridge and get it from the fridge, لا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إِذَا أَذَّنَ الْمُؤَذِّنُ وَالْإِنَاءُ فِي يَدِ أَحَدِكُمْ. Clearly. فِي يَدِ أَحَدِكُمْ. In the hand of one of you. And this does not mean that you intentionally wait until the muaddin say Allahu Akbar, even if you are holding the vessel or the cup. You hold it and wait. Oh, the muaddin said Allahu Akbar, then you drink. La. Then you have turned the permission to be sunnah. And it is permission, not sunnah. The sunnah is to finish before the muaddin. But if it accidentally happened, and during the time of Rasulullah ﷺ, they did not use to have watches or clocks that shows them that they are closed. So one of them, it's dark, one of them might take the vessel or the cup thinking that it's still time. And by the time he takes it, he hears the muaddin begins the adhan. Rasulullah ﷺ, he said, don't leave it until you finish your need. But to make it as a sunnah, hold the cup and wait for the muaddin. And if someone asks you why you're doing this, you say, sunnah, I'm waiting for the muaddin. La, that's wrong. I'm afraid that type of fasting is nullified. The second thing is, as I said, you don't delay intentionally until the muaddin. But if accidentally happen, and today, as I said, you have the watches, you have the alarm, you can know yani, when the muaddin is going to call the adhan. Now, and this is only for water, for drink, not for food. Because water you can swallow it quickly. But food you need to chew it, you need to take it, you know. So it's not for food. And the hadith is clear. وَالْإِنَاءُ. And al-ina is for water, as you said, visit. Wallahu a'lam. Faisal Abu Yusuf, go ahead. You have any question here? You can take now, let me take this from Faisal. Faisal Abu Yusuf says here, Assalamu alaikum, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah protect you and the world. Ameen, and you. And all those who are listening to us. In the UK, we see many different masajid with different Fajr times. How would you advise we follow the best so we do not eat till too late, or we do not finish very early? Some scholars use a scientific method, saying 18 degrees, etc. Jazakallah khair. Wa iyyakum. The best way is to look into this masajid and see who are up on the sunnah most and follow them. Unless we examine each masjid, and we cannot do that. Or the other way is that you yourself go and monitor the Fajr, if you are able to, which is again difficult. Not anybody can know or can do this. If not, then you follow the closest ones to the Sunnah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Those who you see that they like to follow the Sunnah. Naam, Wallahu A'lam. Naam, first. We got Pfizer from Bartok and we got Pfizer from air. We got Pfizer from land now. Yeah. If one overslept during the night and only woke up by the adhan, and the muadhin called the adhan, so he woke up, can he still drink? The answer is no, because he, unless, and if the cup is in his hand or the bottle is in his hand, or for him to go and take the water and drink, except if he knows that the muadhin that calls the adhan in his area calls the adhan for safety some minutes before the time. Some of them or most of them today do that. They call the adhan some minutes before the time. But this need to need high caution. You need to examine it. You don't just say, oh, many of them, this may be one of them. Nah, maybe it's not accepted in this area. Huh? If you drunk with that situation, yeah, you have to do that day again. Nah, Allah. Send us again. Go ahead. We did not see any question for music. Sindhu says, continuing with my previous question, should one make up the fast if they thought that this hadith included food? Wallahi, the proper thing is to make up those days. Make up those days. Because the hadith is clearly about water, and I never knew that the ulama say food is included. So it means that they have eaten after the time has entered, which is not allowed. So I recommend them to make up those days. Allah Akbar. Sajid, go ahead. Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. If a believer falls into major kufr, but then repents from his kufr, then does all his past good deeds become lost and nullified? That's before Allah Ta'ala, that's for Allah. If he sincerely repented, Allah Ta'ala in Surah Al-Furqan said, إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ الصَّالِحَ. Except for those who repent and believe and do good deeds. But if he repents and he doesn't do good deeds, where is the repentance? If he repents and then he comes to some other wrong beliefs, then where is the repentance? But the one who sincerely repents and do good deeds and believe, then Allah Ta'ala will not only will change all of his previous sins to hasanat. What about the previous hasanat? If the previous sins are going to be converted to hasanat, so what about the previous hasanat? Of course, it's going to be also counted for him. Wallahu a'lam. And here we end up the session, inshallah, or of today. Willing to see you, inshallah, tonight. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa barak على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.